thanks for joining us from Dodger Stadium. I'm Maria Serrao, joined by my co-host all the way from the East Coast, Doug Hughes. Doug, now we usually do the spring training show in Arizona, but we brought Doug up to the big leagues this year.
I always look forward to going to Arizona, but this is fun. That for an East Coast guy, LA is its own scene. I've seen more famous people in the last 2 days than I have in a year in Washington, so this is it's a pleasure to be here.
And that's something to be said, considering so much is going on in Washington right now.
Do not start me on that.
That's a whole other subject.
Done.
All right, a little later in the show, we're going to introduce you to some Dodgers. We're also going to talk Clippers basketball. They're on the way to the playoffs. And Doug, how much do you know about swimming and what it takes to be a championship swimmer?
I am one of the better dog paddlers that you will see, Maria.
Very nice. And how many hours a day do you practice that?
That would be a small number.
Small number. All right, well, we're going to talk to some swimmers at Peninsula High School who know what it takes to be a championship swimmer. But right now, we're going to start right here at the Ravine with the Dodgers. They've had a spring training that's been a little dramatic this year, a lot of injuries. So we're kind of hoping that they can pull together for the season.
It's hard for things to go wrong during spring training. You're just feeling your way through. You're seeing the lay of the land. Who's new? Who's good? Who might have gotten old? Injuries are not something you like to see. They're not supposed to happen. It's like preseason of football. You're like, oh no, he got hurt.
Yes.
In the preseason. Spring training is not a place for injuries, and the Dodgers have gotten unlucky this year.
They really have, but one of the greatest things about the Dodgers this year is their new manager in Dave Roberts. Dave is one of the nicest guys that you're ever going to meet. The players love him. The way I explain Dave is Dave's the kind of guy that will put his arm around you when you need somebody to give you a hug, and he's the guy that will take you in the office and have a word with you. He's that guy.
I have neither hugged him nor been taken into his office. Maria, I'm going to take your word.
Then just believe me.
I'm in.
All right, let's talk to the new Dodger skipper, Dave Roberts, right now. Spring training coming to an end. How did it go for you out in Arizona this year?
You know what? It went well. It went well, and we got the guys together, and there was a lot of good energy. We got better, and, you know, obviously there are some unforeseen injuries that we had to deal with, but, you know, outside of that, we're ready to go.
Back in Dodger Stadium, how does it feel? This is your first time as the captain here.
Yeah, it feels great. It kind of takes me back to my playing days, being on this side of the field. You know what? But being back in a Dodger uniform, it's exciting, and the players, coaches, and I know the fans are excited. So it's going to be a great year.
All right, I know rosters aren't set now. I know there's some injuries, but who surprised you, or who are you excited about this during the spring?
Yeah, you know what? A lot of these guys, the guys that have been here, I've put eyes on, and I'm pretty familiar with these guys. But you know, when you look at Austin Barnes or, you know, Ross Stripling, Trace Thompson, these are guys that I haven't seen a whole lot of, and so to see these guys on the major league side, they've been pretty impressive. And also those young kids, you know, De Leon, Urias, and we got some big arms in the minor leagues.
We want to know what kind of DNA Trace Thompson actually has.
Well, I think he comes from a pretty good gene pool. You know what? He's a great young man, great skill set, and an outfielder that can play all three, and he's got power, right-handed power. He's a special human.
All right. Listen, we're going to let you go. You're a special human, too. Thanks
right,
for spending
thank
some
much.
Time.
You, all right.
You know, I just couldn't resist asking Dave Roberts about Trace Thompson and that amazing gene pool that he comes from. I mean, how is that even possible?
I don't know.
It's I'm amazing.
Not, do I look like a biologist to you? I don't know. Yeah, he has a pedigree. People always like that. I used to think they put too much emphasis on that. Who's your dad? Who's your brother?
But when your dad is Michael Thompson and your brother is on his way to maybe a second NBA championship in Klay Thompson, that's just amazing to me.
Apparently, there is something to it.
Right? There has to be.
Yeah, no, it's kind of fun. It's fun when you have overlap and you get dads coaching sons, you had the Griffies playing together, father
exactly.
son. So it's a fun side light in sports, and genetically, apparently, there's something to it.
All right, Dodger pitching this year is going to be a little bit different. Of course, Zach Greinke is gone. He's gone to the Arizona Diamondbacks, but Clayton Kershaw is still the number one. The question is the number two, the number three, the number four, the number five, Doug. We've got some guys out here. Scott Kazmir is now here. We're waiting for some guys to get better. Hinjin Ryu, maybe mid-season. The same with Brandon McCarthy. So this is going to be a different look for the Dodgers this year as far as pitching goes.
It's a different look, and it cannot be as good a look. People say, well, how do you replace Scott Greinke,
Zach Greinke
when
can't.
He goes? You
yeah.
can't. You no. can't. You don't. Jake Arrieta already has a job. Clayton Kershaw already works here.
Yes.
You're done. It's a short list, and he can't be replaced.
Right.
How do you replace your right hand if you cut it off? You don't. You don't add another foot. You don't add a nose. It's a problem. It's a problem for them, and I think it's a big problem. This is an expensive team. It's got a lot of talent. It's got some pitching. It's got Clayton Kershaw, I think still the finest pitcher on the planet.
Yes.
But Zach Greinke was the second finest pitcher on the planet, I believe, and he's not here.
And it's tough when he goes to somebody in your own division, too. That's the really tough part. I think, except for the Giants, the D-backs was the worst possible place that he could have gone.
It hurts you in two ways. Number one, Greinke is gone. There's some wins that he's not going to get for your team.
Right.
Now he's in the division. He plays for an opponent, and there's some losses he's going to pin on you.
Right.
Those two things have to happen. And the Dodgers were already on a pretty close margin last year,
true,
wins and losses. I think Zach Greinke tilts us into a place where they have to get lucky. Somebody's got to step up. The offense has to explode. Something has to happen because you cannot replace Zach Greinke, and they have not done it.
Well, one positive thing is Kent Maeda, the pitcher that they got from Japan, he's been doing really well. He had a great spring. And, of course, you know, there's always a ton of Japanese media here when you have a Japanese player. But they're saying really good things about him, that he's excited. He's doing well. So that's good. That's a plus.
This is fun. This has been one of the good stories of the spring, and maybe Ross Stripling shaping up maybe to be the fifth starter is another good one.
Right.
So that's been a surprise, made a surprise. So a couple of good surprises. As I said, you're going to get lucky. You're going to have the offense explode. But again, Zach Greinke, can you replace him? Maybe Maeda can. Maybe it's going to be a surprise. Maybe I'll be eating these words in a few months. I hope
so. Well, we hope so. Even Mike Bolsinger, who was going to be named the fifth starter, but then he had some oblique issues, he is on his way back to healing. So hopefully they've got a couple of these guys they can infuse as the fifth starter, because they're going to need it. That's the one thing. There's never enough pitching, as Luis Gonzalez once told me. There's just never enough pitching.
And those oblique injuries are tricky. They seem to
they
be
are.
Slow to heal. I was worried. I pulled an oblique recently. I went to my doctor. He could not find it.
And were you worried that you weren't going to be able to do the show today? That's really my biggest concern with you, Doug.
I was more upset about the doctor's joke. He couldn't find my oblique. But yes, it does slow you down. It's very hard to swing a bat, and it can be either debilitating or not a big deal, depending on how you throw, where exactly it is in the oblique. And this one seems to be a little bit of a problem. The slow healing time is the problem. And the second thing is when you rush that back, if you re-injure, if you aggravate an oblique, that's trouble.
Big trouble. Now, somebody else we were concerned about was Corey Seager, who is the phenom. And, you know, he looks to be the next Derek Jeter. He really does. He looks great. He's well-spoken. And he came up last September, and we just saw nothing but good things from Corey.
He does everything. He looks like an athlete. Every once in a while you hear older scouts will say, he looks like a ball player. Like, what
he
do you mean?
He looks like a ball
player. Yeah, I don't know. I can't tell you. But Corey Seager looks like a ball player.
He
and
does.
He does everything. His swing is pretty. He carries himself well. He throws the ball well. He has good presence and awareness around him. There's a little aura that he generates you don't see very often.
Right.
Hopefully not a flash in the pan. Does not look like it. Looks like he's got a good set of basic skills.
Stay.
Yeah, and he's handling himself well. He's done everything right so far. If he stays healthy, I think that's going to be a great thing for the Dodgers.
It is, and we had a chance to sit down with Corey, so let's take a look. Corey, first of all, we want to know how you're feeling. You played last night, and things look good.
Yeah, you know, it's nice to go out there and kind of get a game on your belt and know there's no pain, no anything. You know, you kind of went full tilt last night, all the adrenaline and all that other stuff, and it's kind of another box you can check off, so knowing you're ready.
How was spring this year for all of you guys? I know you're dealing with some injuries, and Dave's kind of juggling balls, but how was that?
You know, it was good. We had some injuries this spring. You know, that's typical. You know, it's always going to happen. You know, you got to be ready for injuries. It was nice to have them now instead of July, June, something like that. You know, it's always nice, but you know, you get to know everybody. You know, it's kind of still like a work in progress. You know, you won't get completely comfortable with somebody yet. So, you know, we're working on it.
Speaking of getting to know somebody, you have a new manager this year in Dave Roberts. What has that been like getting to know him, and what kind of a guy is he?
He's been great. You know, the clubhouse is awesome right now. It's everybody's together. Everybody's got camaraderie. Everything's going well. You know, it's been really upbeat, really up-tempo. It's been good so far.
So you're starting on the road this year. You'll be back in Dodger Stadium for the home crowd. What are you expecting that might be like?
You know, I don't know. I'm excited, you know. Opening day is, you know, an exciting time. It's what everybody kind of looks forward to in spring training. You know, you want to get to that point, and I'm really looking forward to it.
All right. Well, we're going to catch up with you later in the year. We're glad that you're doing better, feeling good, and thanks for spending a few minutes.
Thank you.
And, Doug, in addition to Corey Seager, they're expecting big things this year from Yasiel Puig and Yasmani Grandal, two players that were hurt much of last year, and all of these GMs up in that front office are saying that big things from both of these guys. So you got to keep your fingers crossed and hope, but is that too much pressure for Yasiel to say, hey, you're the guy?
No, I love Yasiel Puig, and I think he is one of the bright spots. We've talked about a couple of gloom and doom. There's some injuries. Pitching staff has taken a giant broadside hit. Yasiel Puig, he is fun. He is incredibly talented.
The wild horse, as Vince Scully likes to call him.
I get frustrated with that wild horse talk.
I love that.
All he is well, because people, I think they mean it a little bit in a negative way. He's untamed. He knows this game. He knows which base to throw to. It's just that he can throw home when other people can't.
So he wants to try.
So he wants to try, but he can't. If you rein him in, you take a little of his personality away. Do you get a better ball player? Maybe. He's so much fun to watch. I think he is great. Everything about him is talented, defensively, offensively, and so far this spring, he looks like he's having fun.
I
think that's important. Well, last year, for a while, he didn't have fun. When he's not having fun, he doesn't bring his joie de vivre. I believe that's a French phrase.
I love that.
Thank you.
You worked on your French
Merci
in the offseason.
Beaucoup.
Merci.
He is a lot of fun to watch. Yes, I'm expecting great things out of him. Yasmani Grandal, you know I like him behind the plate.
He's great.
I get a little bit critical of AJ Ellis. I think
a little bit.
A tiny bit. If you check the old shows, I think Grandal is the answer there. I like everything about him, too. Having a switch hitter as a catcher, giant luxury. I like him.
Somebody that we're hoping gets better this year is Jock Peterson. You know, he had 20 home runs before midseason last year, and then after the All-Star break, he went to 8, and he struggled at the plate. He was in and out of the box. We're really hoping that he's cleaned that up a little bit this year before the season starts.
Frowny face. You see this happen with a golfer when he'll lose his ability to putt. It drove Johnny Miller out of the game. He was a completely dominant player, and then he lost his ability to putt. Jock Peterson, everyone had very high hopes for him. He came in, and they said these were justified, and the guy lost his swing. I don't know what you do to get somebody back in the swing of things, pun intended. He needs to get that swing straightened out because he has it in him. He's just not finding it right now.
Well, what do you do? I mean, what kind of things can you work on to change your mindset into learning a different swing?
You know what I love? The movie Tin Cup, where Kevin Costner is a golfer, and he's lost his swing, and he's using swing aids. He's doing motivational tapes, and eventually his caddy just says, just let the big dog eat. Just stop thinking. And
maybe that's what it is.
This is a problem for a lot of professional athletes, the brain. The brain is necessary to get you to the park and dress yourself. And at that point, you should turn it off and let your muscle memory and everything else go. Seriously, a lot of guys, when they start thinking too much, they have trouble. And if you start feeling like you're having problems, it becomes a downhill cycle. Jack Peterson can be as good.
No more thinking.
That he can be as good as he has been. Maybe that's the answer for him. I'm far from ready to give up on him, but he is struggling.
Yeah. Somebody else who we're hoping will be back very fast is Andre Ethier. He broke his leg in spring training, so it's probably 6 to 8 weeks. And I'm going to tell you something. Without Andre Ethier last year and Howie Kendrick, who's also battling an injury right now, this team does not make the playoffs. These are two players the Dodgers absolutely need on the field. Andre is great in the clutch situations. He always comes up with a big hit. So we're hoping they get back in the field very quickly.
He does come up with a big hit. I do see two problems, though, when it's a problem for your team to lose Andre Ethier. One, you're losing Andre Ethier. He's a good outfielder. But second, you shouldn't be a team that is really hurt
depending
when you
on
lose
Andre Ethier.
Andre Ethier.
Yes.
The fact that he is a big loss to them is not a great sign to me. I'm okay with the rest of the outfield, but it's thin.
Yes.
If someone else goes down, Puig pulls a muscle, now we have some trouble. So Ethier, it'd be nice to have him back. Yes, it's an incredibly fluke injury. Guys hit that ball all the time off their leg, and they hop around, they curse, and they get back in the box, or they take the night off.
They curse. Have you been close enough to hear them cursing?
Yeah, look at this. We're in the front row today. You can hear everything.
I know. Can we just
here.
Sit here for the rest of the
We're
game?
We're not leaving.
This is
we are
so
not
great.
Getting kicked out
I
of
think
these
this
seats.
Is the owner's box, too, but maybe Magic's not here
We're
tonight.
We're definitely getting thrown out.
I think so. You're probably right.
Hopefully that leg heals right up, and he is – there is a spark he adds. I don't like the fact that the Dodgers are as dependent on him as they are. But he'll come back. He'll come back in a month. And from there, he will add the stability he adds and the clutch hits that you point out, which are real.
Amazing. Now, one of the players, I did have a chance to talk to Carl Crawford yesterday, too, as you know, and he looks good. He's excited. He's ready to go. Somebody that has been ready and all of spring training has been batting, 10,000 is Justin Turner. Now, Justin was another one last year. It's amazing to me. He came over from the Mets. The Mets kind of just let him go. And he comes to Dodger Stadium, and he is having his best career right here in Chavez Ravine, and he's ready.
And he's a lot of fun.
Isn't he?
I did not foresee him being the answer at third base. Juan Uribe was here. I thought that was going to go on for a while. I did not see that that Justin Turner was going to settle in. He settled in. He's very popular. He's incredibly confident. He strides around here like he owns the place. I'm like, dude, where's your deed? You know what?
He's got it in his pocket. I think he keeps it on.
He carries it around.
In his locker, maybe.
He does everything. He is a great defensive player. We watched him make a play yesterday, inconsequential in an exhibition game. But his footwork is good. His arm is strong. His swing is good. He's confident. He's a good third baseman. Dodgers doing well there.
Doing well. And we had a chance to sit down with Justin. So let's listen to what he had to say. You had a very good spring. Tell me why it was so good and so beneficial this year for you.
Obviously, if you look at the numbers were great. But I think the more important thing was, how healthy I feel and bouncing back after the surgery and being able to get out there and really have no limitations. The number one goal for me in spring was to be ready to go 100% for opening day, and I accomplished that. So, all numbers aside, I think that's the biggest thing that I'm proud of this spring training.
Numbers are nice, but it's also good to come back from a surgery and do your rehab and really be where you want to be. How long did it take you to get there?
It took, the last time I was here at the stadium before yesterday, I wasn't even allowed to run yet. So I was out in the field doing some stuff, but I hadn't even been cleared to run yet. So the amount of progress that I did make in Arizona, I think, was leaps and bounds of as far as, being able to run, being able to take ground balls, being able to run the bases, hitting, doing all the hitting stuff. Those are some big boxes that I had to check off. And the other thing was bouncing back after playing a game, seeing how I felt the next day, making sure I wasn't sore or wasn't unable to participate the next day. So the amount of progress that I actually got done to get to this point was remarkable to me. And I got to tip my hat to our training staff, Neil Ramp and Steve Smith and, Brian Stoneberg was the strength guy who was down there. They really put together a nice program for me to get me to where I'm at today.
Well, and they're all new guys too. How long does it kind of take you to get to know these guys? You probably know more than others right now.
Yeah, right when Neil got hired, he was here, 5 days a week, and he was driving back and forth from Arizona. So he'd go home for the weekend and then come back during the week so, guys could be here to get their therapy in. I was here, Kike was here, and we had a bunch of other guys here as well working out. So not only him, but Brandon McDaniel, our strength coach here, who is behind the scenes, puts together a lot of the programs. They really did a good job.
All right, you have a new manager this year. What's it been like being with Dave? He's one of the nicest guys you're ever going to meet. What's it like from the player perspective here?
It's been unbelievable so far. I think the most identical thing about Dave is how genuine of a person he is, and he truly cares about you and who you are as a person, not just a baseball player. And I think when you have a guy in his position who's really guiding our ship, That's good to have. It's good to know that he genuinely cares, and it's easy to trust him and know that he's all in, and he's in it for the right reasons, and he wants to be here and he wants to win. And I think guys have responded really well to him so far.
What do you think it's like for him, having been a player, having been played in Dodger blue, and now he's on the other side? What do you think that's like for him?
I think it's awesome. He's an LA guy. He went to UCLA. Yeah. Obviously, like you said, he played for the Dodgers, and then he's been in our division the last couple of years down in San Diego. Yeah. So for this opportunity to come up, things kind of, work out how they work out. And I think he ended up right where he should have been. And, we're happy as can be that, he's our manager this year and moving forward. And, hopefully he can be our manager for a really long time.
We always talk about spring training kind of being like Groundhog Day, but you're going to start on the road. How excited to start that first game on Monday?
Yeah, I think everyone's real excited, especially, we come here every year. We play this freeway series, and it's just a chance to get out of Arizona into a more realistic atmosphere, get these couple games at home, give the fans here a small sample of, what the 2016 Dodgers look like. Not everyone, obviously, can make it out to Arizona to see us, even though we had a ton of fans out there. I think we set another record for attendance in spring training this year, so that was awesome. So thank you to the fans for that. But, guys are excited. We're ready to head down south and get this thing going.
Yeah, Justin Turner really adds so much to this team and so much fun. They're so lucky to have him here, really.
That's true, and it's surprising that the rest of baseball did not appreciate his talent, because it's pretty obvious here.
Especially the Mets. Isn't it crazy?
I know.
You never know.
You do not know. You'll see people who make ridiculous trades, who let people go, who become stars. Sometimes you find a diamond in the rough.
Yes.
For all the scouting that goes on, all the sabermetrics, all the analysis, every once in a while, a Justin Turner pops on through, and he's a surprise.
Well, speaking of scouting, we had a chance to sit down with one scout who's probably the most famous scout in, I was going to say Los Angeles, but maybe anywhere.
I think anywhere.
How many?
I see where you're going with the story.
Yeah.
And how many scouts get the kind of recognition he's gotten? Zero.
And how many have their own bobblehead? Well, I can think of just one, and his name is Mike Brito. Mike, this is your first bobblehead, is that right?
First one. I hope it won't be the last one.
Well, now tell me, did you have input as to how you wanted it to look?
No, well, he asked, he spoke to my daughter three times, and my daughter said, no, I don't like that hat, I don't like that suit. And I told Mike, whatever you like to do it.
Mark, this is your second bobblehead that you've created. What inspired you to want to make one for Mike Brito?
I just thought as a kid, you know, even watching TV or coming to the games, he was the only guy behind home plate you'd always see. And everyone knew him as the guy behind home plate with the hat, the sunglasses, and the cigar with the radar gun. So, I mean, he's a fixture.
This is very specific. So tell me how you designed this.
We designed it. Obviously, we had to have the hat with the radar gun. But what we did is we took it to the next step, and we actually have the head bobble and the radar gun bobble. It's kind of different. And obviously, his signature suit. He's always dressed to the nines, so you got to have that, too.
When Mark first approached you, what was your first thought?
Well, I was trying to get inside the press box. And he was outside talking to the lady that played the piano, the thing.
The organ, yes.
Yes. And then he asked me if I was interested in having my bobblehead. I said, yeah, sure. Bobblehead's better look at mine.
No.
It took about 40 years younger than me.
You know something? I think it looks a lot like you.
It do. Thank you for the compliment.
Well, this is a lot of fun, especially since, again, Mike is so well-known and so loved, and especially here in the Dodger community because of his great work and your great work. You're sort of turning into the bobblehead guy now, Mark.
Oh, thank you. We've had a couple people approach us to make bobbleheads for them as well, too.
Wow. So is there somebody else on the horizon, or should you wait and tell me later?
No, actually, we're doing Roger Owens, a famous peanut man.
Wow.
From Dodger Stadium. We're doing Roger Owens, and he's going to be pitching peanuts, and it's going to be a meet and greet as well. And also the same day, we're going to have another Nancy B bobble. Oh. On this bobble, though, with Nancy B, you're going to push a button, and she's actually recorded taking me out to the ball game, and we've inserted it into every bobblehead.
So, Doug, what do you think we need to do to get a bobblehead made for us?
That would be a good night's sleep with a deep dream, Maria.
That one was pretty spectacular. That was amazing. Sometimes we joke about the fact that the bobbleheads don't look like the players. That one looks like Mike Brito.
There have been some spectacular failures in the bobblehead department.
Yes.
In Baltimore, they canceled the Cal Ripken night because they thought it didn't look like him remotely. They thought it looked like a completely different human being.
And what did they do with the bobbleheads?
They threw them out. They became collector's items. It's like
of
having
course.
A stamp upside down, but
yes.
They went to throw them out. So, yeah, if you ever find a Cal Ripken that does not look remotely like him, you got something special.
That was it. That was it. All right, we are moving on to another story at Peninsula High School. Doug, are you a swimmer?
Doggy paddle, yes.
That's it. I think you did say
that'd be
that.
The extent
right.
of it.
All right. Well, I had a chance to sit down with their team. You know, they go to CIF Champions every year. They're amazing. How many hours in one day do you think that they swim?
You warned me you were going to ask this, and I'm going to say an hour and a half.
How about 3 to 4 hours? 5 a.m., 2 to 3 hours, and after school, another hour or two before homework. Isn't that is amazing to me that they're in the water that much.
Is 5 a.m. the one that's in the morning?
It is. It's that one when we're in Arizona that we have to get up for.
Yeah,
that's another great thing about being at spring training right here at Dodger Stadium. 7:10 games. I love it.
I would have to be in a different time zone for you to get up at 5 a.m. and meet. That's crazy. I knew they were dedicated. I have relatives. My nephew played water polo out of Peninsula High and BV High. But that's crazy.
They're amazing athletes, and I had a chance to sit down with some of them, so let's take a look.
A lot of these top-notch swimmers, they swim in the morning, and then they swim for 3 hours in the evening. So we're talking about 5 hours of swimming a day.
How is it possible that they do that and they still do anything else?
It's tough. I mean, they're really juggling, you know, school and this rigorous workout schedule, and then they have to find time to eat and then have a social life on top of it. But they get it done, and they come up huge at the end of the season when we have our big championship meet.
It's been something like a challenge for me, especially balancing school, social life, and swim. But I kind of was able to kind of mix my social life and swim in a sense. Some of my swim friends became my best friends. And so that way I was kind of able to have fun at practice. And it's not like it wasn't a chore for me. It was something that was like enjoyable. And I think that just like it taught me a lot of skills of like managing my time, because you can't spend like 4 hours watching Netflix and then have 3 hour practices. So it's a great tool for like the future, I think.
This is such it's a grueling kind of a practice schedule. You're in the water a lot. How do you mentally sort of do that and your schoolwork and hang out with your friends and all that?
Yeah, it's funny. I actually had practice this morning, and it is tough. It is tough to get up in the morning and to go to practice two or three times a day. But you learn to balance it out, and it actually helps with time management between school and social life and stuff like that. So
I try to like hang out with my friends if I can, but if I have to swim, that comes first. Same with school.
What do you think is the biggest challenge for you?
The biggest challenge for me, I think, with swimming is keeping motivated, like staying self-motivated. Obviously I have my team that I think about, but also knowing for myself, like remembering why I'm in it and why I love it so much.
You know, those kids work so hard and hours, plus they've got schoolwork to do on top of swimming, and they have to eat, and they have to have time with friends.
I'm still just fixated on the 5 a.m.
All right, we are getting ready for the second season in basketball for the Los Angeles Clippers. Let's go out to Staples Center and hear from Will Lupardus.
Well, Maria, as this NBA season winds down, the LA Clippers have solidified the 4 seed in the Western Conference. Now, that doesn't mean we know who they're going to play yet. The Portland Trailblazers and the Memphis Grizzlies are vying for that 5th seed, and we're probably going to play one of those two teams. Now, the Clippers have undergone quite a season because Blake Griffin has not been with the team for the last 3 months. He's just recently come back, and we have yet to see what this team's going to look like with our all-star forward. The good news is Chris Paul has been the consummate leader. Guys like Jeff Green and Jamal Crawford, J.J. Redick especially, have stepped up to make sure this team has stayed in the top 4 in the West. And regardless of what happens with Blake Griffin, we know we have a Clipper team that can't compete for this Western Conference title. With Blake back, I think the sky's the limit for them.
And that will do it for today's show. But we have to talk very quickly, Doug. You know, this is Vin Scully's last year. What are your thoughts on that?
Vin Scully is such an icon. He's been such a pillar. He was broadcasting World Series games on television before I was born. And I think this, when I see him, he broadcast Don Larsen's perfect game in the World Series in 1957.
Yes.
I was not yet born. And
Are you just trying to make people say that you're really not that old?
No, I was feeling old when we talked about Kobe Bryant. So no, there's no getting around that one. What's amazing is how long Vin Scully has been doing this. It is extraordinary how long he's been doing this. At one job, and at the level he's doing it. Sometimes guys hang on a job. He's not a government employee milking it out here. He's working for
he's
the Los Angeles Dodgers.
Exactly.
Doing Major League Baseball games
every
in a
day.
Highly entertaining and competent fashion, day in, day out. It is absolutely extraordinary. I am going to miss the heck out of Vin Scully.
There's nobody better, and we actually had a chance to sit down with Vin, and he talks about this being his last year, so we're going to leave you with that. And Doug and I will see you on our next show from Angel Stadium. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Maria Serrao for Doug Hughes, and we'll see you at the Big A.
I'm not sure if I'll make it through the last couple of games. I know the last game is here, the last home game, and then there's a weekend series in San Francisco. And as a little kid who was born and raised in the streets of New York, who grew up literally and figuratively in the Polo Grounds and was a rabid Giants fan, and I confess that it's good for the soul, I think I would love to finish in a game between the Dodgers and the Giants. So God willing, it'll work out. We'll see. The best laid plans of mice and men usually go up in smoke, but we'll try.
Vinny, how's your offseason been? How are you feeling?
I feel wonderful. Thank God for that. I had the surgery October the 8th, and I'm just fine. I'm as fine as I've been for 112 years, you know. So, but yeah, I really am fine, and I'm looking forward to the year, very much so. Yeah.